usually when someone speaks of projective geometry, it sounds at most 19th century. It doesn't seem to be a very contemporary theory, but so the goal of my talk is to tell you that there was a certain resurrection these recent decennies, and this is due mostly to the fact that this old projective geometry is actually turns out to be related to very new, very new developing theories. So I will mention two of them: combinatorics well, which is also old in some sense, and also integrable systems that are also, it's also old, but they, this theory was always very active, as unlike the old and good projective geometry. So integrable systems and combinatorics. Well, of course, one could add several other topics which are developing. In particular, curiously, it projective geometry is also used now these days in surgery, in medicine. So you know that the contemporary way to perform a surgery is to, so the doctor enters into the body several webcams, and then one needs to create a three-dimensional picture in dynamics of heart, of other part of the body. And actually, the modern way to do it uses projective geometry, and the picture is much more stable and error-correcting, much more error-correcting than if one uses Euclidean geometry. The reason is that the group of symmetry is much bigger in projective geometry. Okay, so I'm afraid to talk of this topic, because in this part, errors are fatal. Here, we can make any errors we like, and so it's not very important. Okay, so the first part of my talk is called School Number 2 in Moscow. This is the place when I first met Sergei Табачников, and it happened almost 40 years ago. So actually, Sergei doesn't remember me there, because I just started to go to this special school of mathematics. And so Sergei was a teacher there for a couple of years between 1978 and 1980, when I started to go to this school. So actually, the school was almost dead that time for some political reasons in Soviet Union, but the spirit never dies, so it lived somehow. And that was the time when the famous book of Coxeter, Revising Geometry, so was translated into Russian, and it was so we were advised to read this book, and. And so there, this book is on elementary geometry, as probably everybody knows, this very bestseller book of elementary geometry of Coxeter. And so when we read it, it's fascinating. And the most fascinating part was projective geometry. So all these configuration theorems of Dizarg and Papp, also Menelaus theorem. So some fundamental facts that are true for any configuration of points, for any triangle, okay? Unlike Euclidean geometry, where one needs to suppose something about the triangle, okay? And of course, when you read such a book, then you understand that the projective geometry is the most beautiful one, clearly. And the most important thing that we learned in this book, most fundamental, is the cross ratio. Which is defined as follows. So suppose we have four points in a line. I call it A1, A2, A3, A4. Okay, so suppose we fix some Euclidean parameter on this line, and then the cross ratio I will denote it by C. Cross ratio is one way to define this follows. So it is a product of two distances divided by product of the complementary. Okay, and so the magic feature of this quantity is that it is invariant with respect to the action of the projective transformation, so PGL L2. Actually, we also learn from this book that this notion was already known to ancient Greeks. So they knew that two pencils of straight lines through the origin are equivalent if and only if this cross ratio on any section, so equivalent in the sense that there is a GL element of the linear group GL2 that sends one quadruple of into the other. So it is equivalent if only if the cross ratio coincides. Okay, very good. So this is what we learn at school. Now, my second and real encounter with Sergei happened 10 years later after that. Yeah, but so Sergei doesn't remember me, but I remember him very well. He was a very young teacher with a huge curling hair. Okay, one could not mistake. Okay, so the second part is called the Schwarzschild derivative. Schwarzschild derivative on Volga River, on the Volga River. Because we discussed this matter with Sergei on during some conference that happened on a boat along the river, so we have a fantastic memory about it. And so, what is the Schwarzschild derivative? So, suppose we have a function f on one variable, then. Well, the usual way to say Schwarzschild derivative is to write down a quite ugly expression. Triple derivative over first derivative minus 3 over 2 second first square. So this is a highly nonlinear expression, which is called the Schwarzschild derivative. So it is extremely classical. Extremely old, as all I'm talking about. okay, so the good way to think about it is the following. Suppose you have another function, y of x, and suppose it satisfies the following linear differential equation. This is almost tautological because you also can define this u as a quotient of y double prime over y. This may. Okay. But so if we write down such an equation. That, of course, we know that this space of solutions is of dimension 2, so I can choose any two linearly independent solutions. And then the statement that was observed by Lagrange in 1777, I think, in his famous paper about geographic cards. So is that if you take the quotient of these two solutions, these two functions satisfying the same equation, then U is exactly the Schwarzschild of F, well, actually divided by 2. Okay, so this is the way Lagrange defines, obtains this this notion of the Schwarzschild derivative. It was acknowledged by Schwarz himself, and one can find in a footnote in the book of Klein of on Ecosider. Klein says, Herr Schwarz, so I'm indebted to Herr Schwarz for communicating the fact that Lagrange was knew this. So what is, so geometrically speaking, what is going on here? This is the following. So instead of just one function y, so we get two functions. So we obtain a curve. These two solutions will represent linear coordinates. So this will be a curve, gamma of x. And our function f is actually the projection of this gamma onto the projective line, p1. So f is can be understood as the homogeneous coordinate of the curve. Okay, so this is the crucial notion. So it is related to this geometry, projective geometry of curves, this notion. Very good. Now let us go further. Where is the?
Ask a quick question.
Yeah, sure. Oh yeah.
But U is on the one hand, according to the last, U involves three derivatives. But
yeah.
My definition, so to speak, is two.
Yes, it's an amazing, amazing computation. Yeah. Yes. Absolutely. Yes. It's an amazing computation. Not very difficult, but. Yeah, yes, good observation, of course. So this is important that it depends on the third jet. Okay. Now, so, well, so what I have to add some couple of things about this Schwarzschild. So the Schwarzschild derivative as well as the cross ratio, these are kind of universal notions in mathematics, because they appear not only in projective, naive projective geometry, but in many, many areas. So I will not mention all of them, because actually they appear in all branches of mathematics these days. Okay, okay. So personally, I first learned it from Kirillov, my teacher, who observed this appearance of this Schwarzschild derivative in the context of the Virasoro algebra. So it's mathematical physics. It's also related to KdV, Kartoweg de Vries equation. So it is already related to integrable systems. It's related to all branches of math. Okay, so we are still in a very old part. And the last section of my talk, which is it belongs to the old theory, is called 4, 6, and so on, vertex theorem. So this is another very old subject. So we already observe appearance of some curves in the sorry. So suppose we have a let us consider a closed convex curve in R2, like here. So the theorem, which is which was published in the beginning of 19th century by Mahabhadhaya, so difficult name of from Indian mathematician Mahabhadhaya, proved that every closed convex curve in the plane must have at least 4 critical points of the curvature, so 4 vertices. Vertex is the critical point of the curvature. Okay, and we can see it easily on the picture. Okay, so there are 2 minima and 2 minimal points of the curvature and 2 maximal points of the curvature. So this subject was one of favorite subject of Vladimir Arnold, in particular because one can draw a very beautiful picture in relation to this theorem. So let us consider once again a closed curve, and so let us draw normal directions at every point. Let me do it. And then we take an envelope of these points, and we get something like this. So it will be a curve which with cusps, and the cusps correspond exactly to the normal through the critical points of the curvature. So like this. Okay. So these are normal through critical points. Very good. So actually, so this is a caustic. It's called caustic, and Arnold understood it as some phenomenon in symplectic geometry. But the picture was already known to Apollonius. So I really probably should have. So it was maybe typo to say 1956. So maybe it is 56 BC. My talk starts that period. Okay, so Apollonius drew this picture for an ellipse, actually, for an ellipse. But it is also the same for arbitrary closed curve. Okay, so now there are several generalization of this theorem. And so, for instance, there is also six vertex theorem. So 6 points. So with a vertex is, as I told, is a critical point of the curvature. We also can say that a vertex is a point where osculating circle is approximates our curve abnormally well. Okay, so we can continue this and starting from a convex curve, we can consider oscillating conics, so curves of order just conics which are tangent to the current, which approximate the curve as much as possible. And again, there will be points where such approximation is abnormally well. The degree, so these points are called in the classical literature by a strange term, sextactic points. And it, so the theorem says there are at least six sextactic points as a curve. And so unlike this Euclidean version, it cannot be easily seen by a naked eye. But so this is a very classical result of projective differential geometry that says there are at least six sextactic points. Okay, so this is an old part of the story. But so amazingly, there is a result which is relatively new. So theorem which discovered by Etienne Gies from Lyon around 1995 or 1996. I think, which says that given a diffeomorphism of the real projective line to itself, so that we can, if we can, well, imagine at least locally as a function like this in one argument. So given this difference, then the number of points at which the Schwarzschild derivative of f vanishes, so the number of points, is at least four. So again, this number of four. So this is an analog of the four vertex theorem called Gies, theorem of Etienne Gies, about zeros of the Schwarzschild derivative. OK, so clever people already told us that the Schwarzschild is but curvature. Well, okay, so to some extent, because here it's rather the differential of the curvature that we can see. And this is, by the way, a very precise statement in using the Lorentzian geometry. Okay, so so all this subject was very much promoted and liked by Arnold. So Arnold continued this list of theorems. Actually, he can see, instead of conics, he considered curves of higher degrees, degree 3, degree 4, and so on. And he called these points where such a curve abnormally approximate our initial curve gamma. So he called it extactic. And so there was some ecstasy about this. So now I will read you a citation from Arnold. So in some of his papers, he writes, these results show that extactic point theory, as well as flattening point theory, belongs to symplectic and contact topology rather than to projective geometry. So, and here we arrived at a very important contradiction. So the contradiction says, so when you are a kid and then you are completely fascinated by the beauty of projective geometry, but then when you grow up, you become student, graduate student, young researcher, then you realize all of a sudden that there are much more sophisticated theories like symplectic geometry, symplectic topology, or some fundamental Riemannian geometry that are very important. And then all this projective geometry is just an old and forgotten theory, right? Well, so, but, so extending Arnold law, so there is only always someone who told this before you and better than you. So actually, Gelfand told that contradictions are important in mathematics. So without contradictions, there is no way to develop mathematics. So in remaining time, I will explain you that this is, so this projective geometry now has a new life, and it becomes sophisticated again. Okay, so my next part will be combinatorics. Related to combinatorics. So combinatorics starts when you have too many things and you need to organize them in a sophisticated way. So okay, let me take this picture and I add one more point, A5. Okay. Then we will have five cross ratios. So for instance, this one will be called C5 because it doesn't include A5. And then I also have C1, C2, C3, and C4 cyclically. OK, so I have five invariants in my picture. But the picture is two-dimensional, of course, because you know that you can put any 3 points to 0, 1, and infinity. So what remaining is two-dimensional space, which is called here M0, 5. So the space of five configurations of five points on projective plane. OK, so this means that these numbers, this invariance, must satisfy some relations. OK, so relations were so we are still on the old side of the story. So the relations were calculated by Gauss, Carl Friedrich Gauss, who proved that with this cyclic order, if you take two consecutive ci, ci plus 1, then it will be equal to ci plus 3 plus 1. Okay, so again, we have five relations, but only three of them are independent. And so this is the way to realize this two-dimensional surface as an algebraic variety in five-dimensional real or complex space. Very good. So now it was so again, Coxeter that helps us to understand what is going on. Again, Coxeter. Coxeter, inspired by this set of strange relations of Gauss, invented the notion of freeze pattern. Freeze. What is a freeze pattern? Freeze pattern is a some infinite table, infinite matrix filled by some by numbers. So the first row, the first infinite row consists in ones. So then we can put any arbitrary numbers. Let me call it C1, C2, C3, 0. So it is infinite again. Then we need to calculate, and we will calculate in such a way that the whenever we have a diamond like this, we want the determinant to be equal to 1. So the Coxeter calls it unimodular rule. So AB minus CD equals 1. So this is the rule how we can calculate the next row. So here, for instance, we have C1, C2 minus 1, and so on. And so why this is related to this set of Gauss relations? Because actually, what you obtain here is, see, if we put here C4, C5, C3, so this the same row is the first non-trivial row, but shifted, then, and we complete by ones, then this will satisfy to this freeze rule of Coxeter, unimodular rule. So everywhere you get determinant 1. OK, so this is called, so it was invented by Coxeter in approximately 1970. And there was a beautiful paper in 71 73 by Coxter and Conway, who classified all these freeze patterns such that all the entries are integer, positive integers. So, and they, their statement was that the number of freeze is equal to the number of Catalan numbers. So it is related to Catalan numbers. So it's already non-trivial combinatorics, but it is called so enumerative combinatorics. It's a, but if we look at this situation with the cross ratios, so actually what the combinatorics which is really involved into the story, it's not just the enumerative combinatorics, but it is much more sophisticated combinatorics, which is should be now attributed to the domain called cluster algebra. So I don't go into the details, but this way to understand this this invariance, this cross ratios, actually allows us to define a very well, very good, very special coordinate system here. So actually it is sufficient to fix only two of these cross ratios, C1, C4, or C2, C4. So two of these cross ratios that on the one on the same diagonal of this Coxeter freeze pattern. And then you using this unimodular rule, you will easily calculate all the other invariants, of course. Okay? Just use this freeze rule. So this will be the coordinate system in our situation. So it is, it has dimension 2, and we need two coordinates, two local coordinates. And this will give us coordinate system. And then we calculate other coordinates, and the coordinate changes, all these coordinates will form so-called cluster algebra, which is very modern theory of algebra and combinatorics. Okay, and so this is the way to parameterize such space of models. So freeze pattern and that that can be constructed using cross ratios, projective invariance. This is the way to parameterize this kind of model space for arbitrary n of configurations of n points in the projective line. Also, so one why so now we can go to higher dimensional situation. So instead of projective line, we can take projective plane, projective space of any dimension. Okay, and this was done in recently. So all this was done recently. So this so I will now. So we arrive at the last part of my talk, which is called the pentagram map. Pentagram map. So here we will deal with the space of configurations of points in the projective line. So let us consider P2 and n points, say V1, Vn, also cyclically ordered. So Vn plus 1 equals V1 again. okay, so, or we can say n-gon in the projective plane. So let me consider just one example. So n equals 5, pentagon. Then in 1992, Richard Schwartz, present here. So Rich. Not there. No, not here. Of course, the spelling is also different. The whole story is like two Schwartzes. So one is old and one is very young and new. Okay, so, but this is a story already starting to be to have some age. So it's not just a child, not just like Lisa, but it's already. Yeah. Okay, so he suggested the following. So we define a map from, so let me consider some n-gon, I call it P. So I will define another n-gon, T of P. So T will be the map. And the, to do this, I will just cross the shortest diagonals. Okay, so in my picture here, I get new pentagon here. And then we can iterate the process, and this gives us a dynamical, discrete dynamical system on the space of n-gons. Okay, so Rich called it pentagram map just because the n equals 5 is the first case where this can be non-trivially done. Okay. Good. And so he conjectured after some work, and he studied the invariance of this map. So he conjectured that this should be integrable in some sense. Okay, so this was proved later. But before I tell you this, so what is the relation? So first of all, the configuration of n-gons. Now the whole picture, the whole procedure only involves points and lines and intersections. So it is, of course, invariant with respect to the projective group, which is here GL's projectivized GL3. Okay, so it is GL3 invariant. So we call this space of n-gons Cn. So I don't know if it is a good notation, but this is now the notation. So closed n-gons in the projective plane. Quotient by the, so this space quotient with respect to the projective group. So it is just the next moduli space after this classical moduli space of and of points in the projective line. And now the our map T, the pentagram map, just acts on this Cn. Okay. And it is also beautiful to say that, so this is already projectively invariant, but it's also very beautiful to observe that this map actually itself can be defined as a composition of two projective dualities. Okay, so I erase a freeze pattern. So what is projective duality? Projective duality. If you have a curve gamma in projective space, so we are talking of projective plane, then you can, at every point, you can draw a tangent line, which is an element of the dual projective plane. So the projective duality, I call it star, it sends your curve into some curve in the dual projective plane. Okay. Now, in the discrete situation, if we don't have a curve, but we have an n-gon, and we take some point, some vertex vi, then we have several candidates for such a projective duality. So first, we can take this, call it vi star. So this is my polygon P, and I send it to P in the dual plane. Okay, and this is one possible way to do it. So just to join I and I plus 1. Or we could do it I and I minus 1, but it is just the same story up to a shift. Okay, so we call this alpha. Okay, but we also can do it in a more symmetric way. So let me call now this VI star. And so this gives us another map, which is better. So both are involutions, but they do not commute. And actually, it's very easy to check that T is just a combination of two of them. We can do it this. So it's just a composition of two projective dualities, this map. Okay, and so it turns out that this map is an integrable system, so it was proved in several papers. So in 2008, so Rich, Sergey, and I, we proved integrability for a bigger but more simple space of twisted n-gons. Then it was proved independently in 2010 by Fyodor Solovyov, who unfortunately passed away very recently, and again, Rich, Sergey, and I. So we proved it for this initial question, for the closed n-gon. So it turns out that this is integrable. And moreover, it is related to very classical integrable systems. Actually, if again we, so this is we work with the discrete situation. But if we do this, we try to understand what would be the continuous limit of this discrete case. So one possible natural procedure would be the following. So we just take some curve gamma instead of n-gon, then we take 2 points gamma of x, parameterized curve, sorry, plus epsilon, minus epsilon, then we draw a line, and then we take an envelope of this line. So it will be some gamma epsilon, new curve, gamma epsilon, so this, then epsilon tends to zero, and so we obtain a vector field on this infinite dimensional space of curves in the projective plane. And now, choosing in a good way the coordinate system, actually we just realize that this is nothing but the classical Boussinesq equation, which is the oldest infinite dimensional integrable system on Earth. So it was written before this story about Korteweg and de Vries and Russell, who ride a horse.
Hmm? KdV appears in Boussinesq.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So
is it, can,
oh, oh, yeah, oh, sure, sure, as a particular.
As a further reduction.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, yeah, so this can be considered as the older brother of KdV. Okay, and so we are back to the old theory again. So this is why it is always old and new. And this was the way to how we obtained integrability. So since Boussinesq equation is very old and many things are known here, so in particular there are Poisson brackets very well known and studied for Boussinesq equation. And so what we did is we discretized one of them, the simplest one, this Poisson bracket for the Boussinesq, and then we obtained a Poisson bracket which actually corresponds to our situation, which preserves by the pentagram map. It gives a set of first integrals, and which is also related to cluster algebra. And so that was a part of the story. So I will stop here. Thank you very much.